On today's show, comedians Judy Gold, Jackie the Joke Man Martling, and Aaron Berg. It's 3 a.m. on Tuesday, April 17th. I'm David Feldman. We have a lot of show, so let's get right to it. Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Friend me, please, on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. Do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. We get a small percentage of everything you purchase, and it doesn't cost you more money. Please hit the contact button. I answer all my emails. And if you are a subscriber to our premium content, stay tuned. We have a big announcement, a very special treat. If you're a subscriber to our premium content, you will be getting an email in the not too distant future. And we have some wonderful surprises for you to thank you for being a premium subscriber. So we will have a big announcement for the premium subscribers very shortly. As I said on today's show, this is a dangerous one. This is a dangerous show. We have three dangerous comics today. Judy Gold, Jackie the Joke Man Martling, and Aaron Berg. Stay with me. Welcome back. Don't forget to friend me on Facebook and Twitter and go to davidfeldmanshow.com. There's a contact button. I answer. Oh, hang on. My mother's on the line. Ma?
How dare you compare me to Scary Shandling's mother? How dare you? How dare you? I got the information. Stop. How dare you?
I swear to you.
You went on your show and you told Judd Apatow that I was overbearing, that I was crazy, that I overreact, that I'm the reason you go to therapy. Don't lie to me. Do not lie to me. Do you understand? I am sick and tired. Oh, my God. I can't even breathe. I'm tired of your lies. You went on and you told Judd Apatow that I'm a piece of shit, didn't you?
No.
There's one thing you need to remember the next time you say something about me and something negative. I know the size of your balls, and I wouldn't be talking negative about your mother.
Ma? Can you hear me? Ma? Can you hear me?
Hello?
Ma?
Hello?
Ma, can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Oh, hi.
I can hear you.
Is everything okay? Because I'm in the middle of my show.
Oh, you're in the middle of your show. Oh, I'm so sorry to bother you.
Well,
so sorry that you're so important. You know, I don't want to interrupt you.
You're not interrupting.
Fine.
It's just that I...
Well, you just said, do you need something? I'm in the middle of my show, which makes me think that I'm interrupting your life.
Not at all.
Mm-hmm.
I'm glad to hear from you.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm. Is everything okay?
How are the kids?
They're good. Have they called you?
No.
Hmm.
I haven't heard from anyone.
Okay.
I have the radio on 24 hours a day because I need a voice. I need something.
All right.
I get nothing.
Don't say that. You are loved.
By whom?
By me.
By whom?
By me.
Uh-huh. Then maybe I wouldn't be interrupting you.
Your grandchildren love you?
How would I know that? How would I know that?
Because when I speak to them, they say, how's grandma?
I'm your mother. You don't need to talk to me like I'm a guest on your show.
I know, but you're on the show right now.
Now, I understand you had what's his name?
Judd Apatow.
Apatow, the actor?
Judd Apatow.
Yeah, I understand he was. You got interviewed by him.
No, I interviewed him.
I mean, he's a movie star. How did that happen?
Well, I'm in the middle of a show.
I asked you a question.
Well, I'm in the middle of...
I don't care, David. So you hit the pause button.
Have you
ever seen the pause button? It's two lines right next to each other. Pause.
Okay.
Pause. Pause.
You call into my show and...
I sit. I look at the phone. Ring. Ring. Please ring. Nothing. Ring. Nothing. But you have time. You get lucky enough to get Judd Apatow on your podcast. Judd Apatow, the big star.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, I guess I know what your priorities are, David. Did you hear how I said priorities? Because I'm having a stroke.
Taking
it. Did you hear how it came out? That's been happening all the time. Priorities. I can't even say it. Oh, God.
Do you want me to call...
Call who, David? Why is it take? Do you want me to call? Do you want? Finish your goddamn sentence. Did you hear that? I said guys here instead of goddamn. Did you hear that?
Okay, I
because I'm having a stroke. I'm having little mini strokes.
Okay, so I could call Denise.
Maybe you could get your damn ass over here.
Well, I'm in the middle of my show. Do you want me to call Marilyn?
The show. Who are you going to call, David? Who are you going to call?
Cousin Marilyn.
I heard from Marilyn. Apparently, you had your big star, your big showbiz person, Judd Apatow, on your radio show, whatever you do, the blog. Apparently, you related to Gary Shandling.
Judd Apatow directed a documentary about
it. I understand. I heard from Marilyn. Something about he did a movie of the week for HBO where he played Gary Shandling.
It's on HBO. And it's about Gary Shandling. It's really great. Did Marilyn?
But Marilyn told me that you had the Judd was playing Gary Shandling, and so you had him on your show, and you were talking about Gary Shandling and his mother. And you mentioned something about how you could relate to him. Am I getting this right, David? That you could relate to him because he had an overbearing mother?
I said that it was an artist's path. And if you're an artist, you could...
An artist's path?
Yeah.
To have an overbearing mother? You're lucky you have a goddamn mother.
Okay. Could I call you back after the...
You're lucky you have a... Oh, God. You're lucky! No mother should have to put up with a son like you.
I didn't say that you had...
No one likes you, David. No one.
I didn't say anything about you.
So Marilyn's a liar. Did you see how Marilyn came out? I could barely say Marilyn. Did you hear that?
Say it again.
Marilyn. Marilyn.
Try it.
Did you see? I can't even enunciate.
Mar.
Mm-hmm. Mar.
Eh.
Eh.
Lynn.
Lynn.
Marilyn.
Marilyn. Not going to talk like a robot for the rest of my life. Oh, God only knows how long I have. God only knows how long I have. God only knows. So, so sorry for being overbearing.
I didn't say that.
Oh, so Marilyn's a liar now?
I said...
Fine, David, fine! Fine!
I said...
What happens when I bump into Judd Apatow at an event? Yes, I'm David's overbearing mother.
I never said...
Is that how you're going to introduce me to him?
I never said you were over...
I go to the JCC.
Ma, I'm sorry. I never...
You're sorry! You know what? I'm not going to be the butt of your goddamn jokes anymore. Overbearing? That's what you think of me? That's what you think of me?
I never said...
I know a lot about you, so I would keep my goddamn mouth shut. Criticize someone else, David! Criticize someone else! I'm hanging up. Don't call me. I don't want to talk to you again.
All right. Ma? Can you hear me? Ma? Can you hear me?
Hello?
Ma?
Hello?
Ma? Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
David?
Yeah.
If I die.
Yeah.
There is a frozen chocolate cake, chocolate fudge cake in the freezer for you. And there is stuffed cabbage also in the freezer. The key is underneath the geranium pot.
Okay.
Call me after.
I want
to talk to you.
I'll call you after the
show. All right. Okay? I love you.
I'll talk to you later.
All right. So long.
Enjoying today's show, please remember to do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com, hit the Amazon banner, click on it, and then shop away. We get a small percentage of everything you purchase. I promise you, every penny we get goes towards keeping the show going. And if you're doing your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website, hit the contact button. Let me know so I can thank you. Is this Aaron Berg?
Yes, you've reached the Aaron Berg Freedom of Speech Hotline. How you doing, Mr. Feld de Jurman?
Joining us from Toronto today is Aaron Berg. I guess you're reined in, right?
Yeah, with semen from the clouds of gay Canada. It is so delicious. The Prime Minister leads the parade. It's gay, everybody. Your healthcare dollars at work, mostly to pay for PrEP. That's right. It fights AIDS before you get it. Canada AIDS is just a hockey team.
Most of it goes towards PrEP?
Yeah, PrEP is a drug that fights HIV. The gay community takes it before they have unprotected sex on Satan's watch. And then what happens is they don't get AIDS. I talk to so many gay people here because there's only 4 straight people in Canada. And
so you're saying Canada is a gay country.
I'm telling David, they don't even have those things that go around and plow the snow because that's too manly. They just have one gay guy figure skating up and down Young Street with a little dustbuster going, zoom, zoom, you can go, zoom, zoom.
All right. So I understand you pissed off the entire nation of Canada. You're an American now, right?
Well, I'm still a Canadian, but I'm a permanent resident of the United States of America and the flag under which we believe and stand.
You're married to an American, although that's not what you don't call her an American. What do you call her?
A bitch. Yes. I believe it's a native word for wife. A bitch.
Okay. All right. You can't do that.
I can't. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Even though I pushed you there.
Yeah.
We're pissing people off today. So, okay. Canada is a great country. I love Canada. Let me tell you why.
Because you're gay. Because you're gay. I drove by this place on Church Street called the David Feldman Glory Hole Memorial. And And what it is just these holes that have been set up with different types of satin and other materials. And they go, Feldman was here. And then there's a whole bunch of like Wayne and Schuster drawings and just like little drop buckets for all the loads that you dropped throughout the years.
You know, that's a good thing. To be gay is a good thing.
Yes, it is.
You should be proud that you're gay.
Yes, you should.
Yeah.
You are.
And maybe I'm gay. Doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Right?
Doesn't matter. Whatever is between you and Uber Eats is between you and Uber Eats. I'm not judging you. I was gay for a while. I experimented, you know.
When you say Uber Eats, you mean that I'm ordering food and then bringing
gay men are showing up.
And they're supposedly they're delivering food, but when they're delivering something for me to eat, but it's not in a takeout box. Is that what you're saying?
Penis. Yes. Penis.
So you're saying that's how it's done these days.
I have no idea. I'm flaunting my own ignorance.
Maybe you know too much.
Perhaps I doth protest too much.
Yes, you doth. Now, what happens if your son doth say to you that he's gay? Now, you don't have
first,
a, you don't have a, you don't
right.
have a
first
son.
Of all, I would say, who the hell are you? Get off my property. I have no son. And then once he goes, no, Dad, you had me years ago. I'm gay. And then I would go, I have no son.
all right. But, you know, but let's.
I would be totally accepting of it. I'm a huge fan of gay people. I have many friends that are gay people. I've had a gay man's penis in my mouth. And that's how I got on this podcast. So what are you going to do? There's no business like. Is this your Writers Guild card that I'm cleaning myself up with?
Okay, so when you call Canada a gay country,
yeah,
are you putting it down or are you celebrating it?
I'm celebrating it. It's just you know, the very, and I'm joking when I call it a gay country. There's a better word for it.
Yeah,
it's very tame, very progressive, very accepting, almost too accepting.
But why? Why is that a bad thing? That's a good thing to accept one another, Aaron Berg.
I believe, and here's what I believe in what I saw this week. And you'll excuse me if I go without being funny for 12 to 18 seconds. the realm of people that are supposed to be tolerant have come together so much that now they're actually oppressive towards people that aren't in their quote-unquote inclusive mass. So there's been a swing in the pendulum, and the power has transitioned, which is a very good thing. Which is a very good thing, because I'm going to say this, and I may get flack for it, but, like, you know, straight white men, you know, you have friends of them. You've probably transitioned some of them. They were in power for a long time, for the last, I don't know, 3 or 4 months. And then what happened is now women have power, and now, you know, other types of people have power. And they are, it's amazing to see how power absolutely corrupts. And it's not a man or woman thing, it's a human thing. So there has to be some kind of equality. Equality is the best thing all around.
Equality is the best thing. So do you think that by giving women as much money as men, we're losing our equality, that we become less than?
No, I think that if women do the same job as men and they do the same hours and they're as qualified, they should get the same money. I don't think they should get the same money if a woman comes in and she's like, hey, I work at a McDonald's and you're a lawyer. Why don't we get paid the same thing? You know, there's qualifiers in this. You agree with that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's so, not a good
so
guess.
You come to Canada. See, you have the same reaction when you're in Canada that I have when I go to San Francisco. I consider myself a San Franciscan. And do you know what I mean by that?
Yeah, I do. You prolapse easier once you get to the old 49er stadium, if you know what I'm saying.
I do a pro-am lapse.
Yeah. You like to wear a trench coat, so it's easier to show your goods to the whole tenderloin district, if you know what I'm saying.
I consider myself a San Franciscan because I grew up in New York and New Jersey. I moved to San Francisco where I was healed. And do you know what got healed in San Francisco?
The Castro District.
Do you know, I was hurting and I came to San Francisco and San Francisco healed me. And for 12 years, it made me a better person. It comforted me and it wrapped me in a warm blanket. And I met a beautiful woman. We had kids and I became a better person. I stopped flinching. Mm-hmm. I was nurtured. And then I left San Francisco.
Yeah, a better person.
I left a better person, and then I began to resent San Francisco for being so kind to me and gentle.
Right.
Because all it had to offer me was gentleness and love, and I wanted more. And I think you have the same kind of relationship with Canada. I think Canada raised you. It reared you. Do you know what I mean by rearing you?
Do I? Yeah, It was behind me. It pushed me ahead. It reared me.
Uh-huh. And then you go back there. You went back there and you worked with evil Mark Breslin.
He loves you, by the way.
I know. I love
him. We had dinner the other night.
Will he do my show?
Yeah, he'll do
the show. I got to have him on the show. I love Mark Breslin. You work with evil Mark Breslin, mm-hmm. who can't wait to stir up the poop. And what kind of show did you do in beautiful Canada, my beautiful country, Canada?
Where we did a show that was originated at the Comedy Cellar in New York, which is a very good club in New York. And they had a show called White Guys Matter.
Yeah. What?
And
who was on the bill?
In New York, it was Kevin Brennan, Mike Vecchione, who just killed on The Tonight Show on Friday.
Great.
Nick Griffin, mm-hmm. old school white dude. Dave Attell, little name you may recognize. And then Aaron Berg. And it was a killer show. Diverse, inclusive. The people working in the kitchen were allowed in. And then we did.
Okay. Now, do you think that that's a harmless way to do a show?
I think so. Now, let me say this. In New York, which is a very progressive place, there was not one peep, not one mention of protest, nothing. And then we brought the show to Toronto, did some pre-advertising. 2.5 weeks ahead.
Yeah.
Not a peep. And then one day before, they blew up.
Did it blow up?
They blew up. It was insane. It's been international news still as we speak today.
Now, why do I think that evil Mark Breslin was walking around with an erection the minute it blew up? The promoter of the show, the owner of the club.
He loves controversy. He thanked me. He said, thank you for making me relevant again. And because he built that company on, you know, being edgy and being shocking. And
the story about how I met Mark.
You went in and you're like, here's a drawing of the man that raped me. And then and they go, this guy? And you go, the webbed finger. I knew it. And that's the story.
I was playing Vancouver.
Uh-huh.
And I was walking the audience every night. And
no, you weren't.
Yes, I was. Ask Mark. This was in the late 80s, early 90s. I'm playing Vancouver, which is the home of Greenpeace. And I'm crapping on the Sierra Club and whales and dolphins and saying the planet isn't worth saving. And people were walking out and complaining. And every night the show would finish. The room would be empty. And I kept waiting to be fired. I get paid. After a week, I go home. Get a call from Mark Breslin in Toronto. He owns the club in Vancouver. He goes, is this David Feldman? I go, yeah. Uh-huh. He says, I heard you walk the entire audience every night for a week. Yes, I did, Mark. How soon can you be here in Toronto? I swear to God, he said that. Nobody believes me, but it's true. You know Mark, right?
Well, that's the same story that happened with Kinison to a degree, where Kinison walked everybody. Breslin went back. Handed him $100. Kinison thought he was getting his pay for the night and he was getting kicked out. And then Breslin goes, this is a bonus. You do it again tomorrow, you walk him. I'll give you another $100. So you need to get your accountant on Breslin and go, hey, I walked 4 shows. You never gave me the bonus. I want the equality that the fat guy with the long hair got.
So what is the thinking Why do you want to piss people off, Aaron Berg? What's wrong with you and Breslin and David Feldman?
I love how you've somehow been worked into this via inclusiveness excluding you.
What is wrong with you people? And by you people, I mean Jews.
The Jews.
The Jews. Yes. What is it? Whatever it is, I'm against it, as Groucho Marx used to say. What is it?
You know. Yeah, I know.
That white people have had it easier, that if women and gays and blacks and Mexicans all get a leg up, they're going to piss on you because you can't. No, if they all get a leg up, everybody benefits. You know that. That's how you were raised. And yet you have to taunt the Canadians.
Yeah. Do you know why?
Why?
Because the scene, it's not about comedy, David, and this is comedy. And comedy is sacred. Funny comes first. And when people are trying to make it not about funny, that's when funny has to step in and say, no, no, it's about funny. It's not about you needing a safe space to talk about your period or your orgasms and then think that you're better than female comics that work comedy clubs because they invented period and orgasm jokes. Mm-hmm. So it was just a lay. It was to come in and stir up the comedy scene and really get the real comics to stand up and get the hobbyists to acknowledge that they're hobbyists and that they aren't allowed to dictate the professional rules.
Yeah. Well, don't you think, though, it's kind of hard not to be funny? I'm being serious. Did you ever try not to be funny on stage and say the things the audience wants to hear? Did you ever have the courage to go 45 minutes without a laugh? And have everybody then walk up to you and call you brave? I mean, don't you think there's some courage in not getting laughs? And
yeah, I would do that, and I would call it a theatrical production of a David Rabe play. I would do Hurley Burley, even though it's not relevant anymore, and that's what I would do. But I wouldn't call it stand up comedy. And I mean, stand up when you have like the front runners of the art form complaining that, you know, and I'm not saying there's too much political correctness. I'm not saying that because I work as a stand-up every night, so I know what audiences laugh at, and that's not the case. But when there's comics trying to ruin comedy for other people, hobbyists more than comics, then I feel like that's when someone has to step in. I'm not trying to be a martyr. I'm still, you know, trying to make high six figures a year and just buy a house in Jersey and be able to cheat on my wife. But it's like... I'm not aiming for this martyrdom, but it was a really nice feeling to stir shit up. I'm not going to lie. I haven't done anything like that in a very long time.
But aren't there laws in Canada that prevent you from talking this way?
Yes. One is you must have a penis in your mouth at least 22 hours a day. While at the voting booth, if you are not vaping medical marijuana whilst endorsing three brand new refugees from a country that starts with an S and ends with an A, you will be selected for jury duty. I think that's how it goes. Yeah.
But you want Syrian refugees taken into your country?
I didn't say Syria. It could be Somalia as well. You did not catch on to the S and the A right there, David. I was two steps ahead of you.
Slovakia? Slovakia?
Oh. Ooh, there's three. A zinga.
Samosa, yeah. Is that a...
No, that's a food.
Oh, okay. So,
yeah.
Swahili?
Shakira. Swahili? Shakira.
Yeah.
Swahila.
Right. Yeah.
But
you want Syrian refugees taken in. You want people protected. That's your roots. You come from that. Your grandparents were probably refugees. Right? Who assumed the Jewish identity so they wouldn't get caught as Nazis, right? Weren't your grandparents Nazis?
I believe that's it. And then they put putty on their noses. And, and they feigned vision issues so that they could... they took their pubis and tied it into braids along the sides of their ears and said...
Don't you bleed for the weakest among us?
Yeah, I do. Of course I do.
So what's wrong with Canada?
It just needed a little bit of an American shakeup.
Canada celebrates weakness. or what we perceive as weakness.
Mm-hmm.
You have a child, don't you?
Yes.
Is the child weak?
No, I put her on testosterone.
We love and nurture the weak so that they grow to be strong and loving and caring. That's what Canada does. That's why America is inferior to Canada.
Hmm. Boy, oh boy. But here's the conundrum that I'm caught in. I get to do whatever I want in America and not compromise the art. I don't want to say my art because no, I don't own it. But to do my work the way I want to do it in America, and due to the size of the population and due to freedom of speech, I'm allowed to do that. In Canada, I don't think I would be allowed to do that. Now, well, I could be wrong.
Well, you just did it. What happened?
Now, if I were to stay here, see, what happened is I did it, and then I ran to the airport, and I go, get me out of here, quick. I just did something called freedom of speech, and then... I don't know. I you know, sometimes first of all, Toronto's not a great city anymore.
Are you still in Toronto?
Yes, I'm in Toronto. I was reined in.
Nobody can rein you in. Yeah, that's a pun. See, yeah. Let me just stop for 1 second. That was, you could give me a talk show on True TV like Chris Gethardt for that last joke. Nobody can rein you in, Aaron Berg. That was a pun. Nobody was hurt. It was gentle.
Hang on, I just texted True TV, and it looks like it's happening.
I'm on Truvada TV, by the way.
Yeah, you are on Trivial Pursuit, a new game.
By the way, what is that clicking sound?
That's my hip. I'm trying to engulf my penis in my own mouth because I just saw police drive by, and it's part of the 22 hours where you must have a fellatio occurrence.
What is that clicking? Are you on a headset?
I'm on a headset. There's a little bit of rain dripping. I'm outside.
Maybe the microphone is rubbing up against something?
Oh, that's that. How's that?
Good. I think what happens is you become careless with the headset, and it kind of rubs up against you.
I'm being careful with the headset now.
Okay. So, all right. So you did the shows.
Yeah.
And people protested. What kind of protesting?
I think 8 people stopped by, looked at the sign, and then walked away.
No, you said it was international.
It was all over this new thing called social media. You should look at it. But it's like Bitcoin, but angrier. And they got really upset on social media. But I don't get involved in it. I just...
What were they saying? What were they saying?
Let me read you some of the quotes. Bear with me a moment here.
And okay. And while you're looking for the quotes,
I will take my penis out of my mouth. And, okay.
In accordance with the Canadian law that a penis must be in your mouth at all times.
Yes.
So are they saying that you're trivializing the plight of black people? Especially,
yes.
What about African Americans in Canada?
No. Such thing. Let me see here.
Are African Americans getting shot by cops in Canada?
No, they're not. No. There's a bigger problem.
Is that because you don't have cell phones to record the shootings, or they're really not getting shot?
They do. What they do is they go around with a musket, and no, it's not a problem here. But they do stand in solidarity with the Black Lives Matter in the United States. There's more of a problem here with violence against the Aboriginal community.
Yes, there is.
Yeah, it's a much bigger problem. So I will now read you a Facebook message I was sent privately, April 11th at 11:50 a.m. from a woman named Shannon that said, I am working so hard, in capitals, to get your hateful, racist, misogynistic show canceled. By the way, no commas in that rant.
Okay.
And then in caps again, cannot wait till I'm successful.
All right. So, okay. Now, I agree with Shannon.
Yeah, I knew you would.
I'm on her side. What's wrong with me that I love the fact that she's so angry and I want to keep her angry? What's wrong with me?
You want her to win because you think deep down she's right. However, she lost. So now you like her more because she lost and comedy won.
What are you doing? Are you typing? What are you doing?
What are you doing?
No, I was trying to find more stuff on the phone
Oh, you're clicking something. Okay, yeah. So you just want to go after the angriest people.
No, I just want to be funny and stir shit up with people that aren't funny that think they are funny.
Okay, but what about going after right-wing conservatives?
Mm.
They have guns.
They're pretty funny.
why are they funny?
Because it's silly.
It's wrong. Ignorance is funnier than smart, correct? This is the problem. Let me explain to you what the problem is with comedy vis-a-vis, and I like to say vis-a-vis a lot, but I use it properly. Comedy vis-a-vis the politically correct movement. It's funny to be stupid. Stupid is funny.
Right.
Conservatives are stupid.
All of them?
Yes.
Come on.
Republicans are stupid. It is stupid to make sweeping generalizations about blacks, gays, Arabs, Muslims, women, so that it's funnier. Right. It's funnier. Liberals are smart. Democrats are smart. So your comedy has to be smart. And when comedy is smart, as Chris Rock has said, smart and hip is the enemy of wit. He kind of said it. He said,
if he said that, he would have said it three times. He would go, smart and funny. Let me tell you, smart and funny. Let me tell you, smart and hip. I'm going to tell you this. Smart and hip is the opposite. The opposite of funny. It's not funny. It's not funny.
Yeah.
That's how he would say it. Everything.
This is the conundrum that comedy, this is what you're up against, you young comics. Now listen to me, okay?
I'm 46 almost.
Okay. This is the, because I've been doing this. This isn't my first gay rodeo. Mm-mm. You know, they used to have gay rodeos? Seriously.
Yeah. You've been doing this podcast for 17 hours. I know. Continue.
Okay. Stupid is funnier than smart. It always will be. Stupid is funny. I get laughs by being stupid. You get laughs by being stupid. The audience enjoys stupidity because it makes them feel smart. Stupidity is fun. It's funny. We love Archie Bunker. When you're playing the clubs, it's more fun to be stupid. And the problem that we're up against is when we're being stupid, we're saying stupid things. And you run the danger when you're saying stupid things of saying racist, homophobic things. That's
right.
Misogynistic things. That's the problem. Now the question that we're up against is being stupid dangerous? And you have a president who's pretty stupid, and you have some voters who are pretty stupid, and it's pretty funny.
Right.
It is. It's pretty, you know, you watch Donald Trump. I'll say this. I wish him nothing but the worst, but there's a huge part of me that enjoys him and enjoys what he does to my mother and me and people I love. He makes me angry and frightened, and it's funny.
Yeah.
It is.
Provocative. It's performance art.
So how do you resolve this? How do you get audiences to understand that stupid is funny? And how do you get comedians to understand that stupid is dangerous?
You're right. And I'm going to say it's very gay and very Malian, what you just said.
But can you understand, have you ever been Jew-baited?
Yes, there was one time somebody put a pastrami sandwich on me with a hook.
Which was nose, actually.
We went out to try and catch carp in the Central Park pond. I was Jew-baited.
Have your slaves ever baited you? Have you ever been masturbated? That's a harmless pun. That, like, Chris Gethard would like that.
What is with you and Chris Gethard? Did he just leave your house?
No, I watched True TV the other night, and I watched his talk show. And I thought, God bless that man.
Yeah.
God bless Chris Gethard. There isn't an ounce of hostility in him. It's all about love and tolerance.
yeah,
and sympathy. I can't do that.
I
have to piss people off.
On the surface, you look like you could be a Chris Gethard person. And then you get to know you and you're like, ah, oh, this guy has the rage of a man that had never got his reparations. You're that angry. But on the outside, you look like, oh, sure, I'll show you the way to the Cross Bronx Expressway. But on the inside, you're like, give me your kike-mobile. That's it. Get out of the mother beeping car, you son of a Yehudin. Give me your vehicle. Ah, I got my goddamn tallest caught in the fucking side door. You son of a bitch, my payas are waving because it's a convertible. Brick and mortar, motherfucker. We built the pyramids out of brick and mortar.
If you and Breslin, is Breslin Jewish?
Yeah.
Of course he is. Of course he is.
But he paid for dinner.
What is it about us that we come, wherever we go, we have to stir up shit? Hasn't Canada been nice to you?
I'm going to tell you why. Because you and I are spoiled little Jew babies.
Yeah.
We were taught by our mothers, you're special. You can do whatever you want to do. We're spoiled little Jew babies. They took our foreskins. They won't take our integrity. So we rail against the status quo. And I hate to tell you, the status quo ain't what the status quo is in America. Up here, the status quo is these little collective groups that want to say everybody has to be equal, but they don't like equality. And the comic's job is to rail against the status quo. That's what it always has been. That's what it always will be. You agree, but you don't want to agree. I understand it. This experience has made me much more loving and much more accepting. And my black friends that heard about this, you know, came over to the house with handguns. And my friend John Paul, who's like a Caribbean black dude, came over and he's like, wow, there's a lot of confusion. And he came over and Instagram pictures with his kids and my kids and just showed everybody we're equal. And then I paid him and I said, thanks for doing that. And it's made me, you know, much more aware of the differences between people and has made me more loving because I got to stir this shit up. So I think that part of it is to have an ongoing dialogue. And I think things like this create dialogue and create conversation. So even though it may be viewed as a negative thing because it upset people, it will bring people together individually.
There is a genocide going on in America when it comes to blacks. Blacks are warehoused in prisons way beyond proportion. It's disproportionate the way prosecutors choose to prosecute drug offenses, the way we discipline black kids in schools versus white kids. And every day there's a story, a video now of two black guys being asked to leave a Starbucks because they're...
No, that was 2 days ago. It's not every day. That was 2 days ago.
Yeah, but, you know, the kid who knocks on... The black kid who knocks on a retired fireman's door and says, I need directions, and he fires a rifle at him.
That sounds horrible.
Yeah. And that happens every day in America.
Yeah.
There's a war against black people.
I know. I watched the Netflix documentary. I saw it.
13.
Yeah.
There's a war. There's social engineering that has taken place for about 200 years, especially since Jim Crow, where black people were forbidden by the federal government from living with white people. And the federal government and the states have enforced a type of apartheid. And this is not a conspiracy theory. It's proven. You know, black people are second class citizens. Many black people in America are second class citizens. So,
right.
You know, you're gonna piss people off when you say white lives matter. It's
I didn't say that. I said white guys matter. And mm-hmm. it wasn't my show. It was somebody else's
yeah.
show.
It's funny. It's always funny. Mm-hmm. It is funny. I probably would have done the show if I had been yeah. booked on it.
yeah.
If you know, and the fact that Attell did it, because it's going to piss people off. By the same token as Jews, if people were trivializing the Holocaust, would you go, they're just stirring up the shit?
What's his name there? That very clever guy that used to write for Seinfeld and then had his own show.
Larry David.
Oh, yeah. He's humorous. He did a Holocaust joke last year. Everybody got upset about it. And he's a Jew. And I wasn't offended by it. Were you offended by it?
No, it was very funny.
Yeah.
And you and I were doing Auschwitz jokes before the show started today.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody answered the phone and said crematorium.
Yeah, and I said reservation for $6 million.
Yes, but we didn't do it on the show. But here's the other thing. That's kind of like our N-word.
Mm-hmm.
Like, black people get to say the N-word. We don't. We get to make Auschwitz jokes. They don't. So what
I say the N-word a lot as a joke. Netanyahu. Netanyahu.
Oh, that was so... You really... Okay. That was genius, by the way, because you at first. Okay. That was really great. You're a genius.
Thanks.
You really are a genius. You know that?
Bring it out of me. You bring it out of me.
No. Okay. We're going to wrap it up. I love you. Right. I think you're a genius. I really do. I've been doing this for a long time and you're a genius. You really are. And you're playing with fire. You really are. And I respect that. And I can't imagine anything more enjoyable than going out to dinner in Toronto with you and Mark Breslin.
That must do
been,
it.
That must Next. Have been. Yeah. Yeah.
It's great. Wonderful dinner. We yeah. laughed and giggled. And
is Joel Axler around? You're too young to know Joel Axler.
I know Joel Axler very well. I saw him a few years ago. He's not around in the same capacity as he used to be, but he's still around. I think he lives in a small farm town with a goyim wife now.
Yeah, and poisoned water, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
Did you know that?
Flint, Michigan. He started it.
I think he lives in the Flint, Michigan of Canada.
Yeah.
I'm serious. I think yeah. the last time I spoke to him, he was a Jew poisoning wells, as Jews are wont to do. And
I'll hide my gold here and then come back for it. Your gold has ruined the water source of Walkerton, Ontario. That was the name. That's the name of the place. It was Walkerton, Ontario. You're absolutely right. I remember now. Poison and water.
And what? And Joel moved there. And what caused the poison? Was it Joel?
What? Yeah. He dropped his Jew glasses. Oh, well. I dropped my glasses. Oh, boy, there was asbestos in those.
By the way, he was running the club in Vancouver where I was walking the audience every night.
Wonderful.
He and Mark are best friends. So you've got a night in Canada. It's a forced vacation.
Mm-hmm.
What are you going to do?
I am going to get off the phone with you, and I'm going to go down to the Air Canada Center and watch the Toronto Maple Leafs play the Boston Bruins.
You're going to the game, or you're going to watch it on TV?
I'm going to the game.
See, you're a better man than I am.
Yeah.
At least that's what your wife says when we're...
Yeah.
You know. All right. What is the name of your CD?
My album is called Mr. Manners Live from Long Island City.
And you're not going to be at the Stand this Monday night, but you're at the Stand every Monday night.
Every Monday, 10 p.m. for Frantic.
And where are you going to be performing next?
I will be at Stand Up New York Tuesday and Wednesday this week. And then I'll be at Yuck Yuck's Niagara Falls Thursday, Friday, Saturday.
In Canada or the United States?
Canada.
That sounds like, hang on. So you're going to be at Yuck Yuck's in Niagara Falls. What's the city?
Niagara Falls.
This Friday and Saturday?
This Thursday, Friday, Saturday.
Wow.
Yeah.
That sounds great.
Wonderful.
Stay on the line for 1 second. I love you, buddy. Stay on the line for 1 second.
If you're enjoying today's show, please share it on Facebook, Twitter, StumbleUpon, Dig, Reddit. Copy and paste the link to this show and share it with all your friends via email. Spread the laughs, spread the knowledge, spread the love. Joining us, Jackie, the joke man, Martling.
Woo!
You got to subscribe to his Twitter feed. I do screen captures of your Twitter, your tweets, your Twitter tweets. Some of the stuff you're tweeting out is absolutely hysterical, like knockdown, drag out funny.
Did you hear that, folks? Go to @JackieMartling on Twitter every day at 4:20 p.m. International Marijuana Time.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, it just makes you laugh. If you just want to laugh, I just want to laugh.
They're just goofy. That's all they're meant to do is be goofy. Not harmful, not hurtful, just fun.
Yeah, it's just, I just want to laugh. I don't want to apologize. I spend my whole day apologizing to everyone, including myself.
So there's two guys in the doctor's office, and the first guy says to the other guy, what are you in here for? Another guy says, I got a prostate problem. A prostate problem. What's that? He says, I piss like you talk.
Wow.
What did Hitler say when he dropped the soap?
What?
Still trying to get away, Drew? So a kid comes home from basic training and his father says, how was it? He says, I don't know, Pop. The first week they took us up in a plane to skydive, to parachute. And I was so scared. I was so scared. I didn't want to do it. I was standing with my chute on. I didn't want to do it. And the sergeant looked at me and said, son, if you don't leap out of this plane, I'm going to fuck you in your ass. His father says, did you jump? He says, a little at first.
Jackie the joke man.
What do you say to a girl with no tits?
What?
Nothing.
Jesus. Okay. That. All right.
Why, what's this? Vroom. 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 That's Donald Trump trying to drive through a blinking red light. All right, do some plugs, will you?
Okay, hang on. Oh, my God. Okay. The Joke Man, Bow to Stern. That's the name of Jackie the Joke Man's book. You can buy it over at JackieTheJokeMan.com. The Joke Man, Bow to Stern.
In hardcover, it's in Kindle, and it's also an audiobook.
You can see Jackie the Joke Man at the Dolphin Bookshop and Cafe in Port Washington, Long Island at 299 Main Street, Port Washington, Long Island. He'll be doing a book signing 7 p.m. Thursday, April 26th at the Dolphin Bookshop and Cafe, 299 Main Street, Port Washington, Long Island. And then,
yep,
June 9th, 7 p.m. Saturday in Belmore, Long Island, the Brokerage Comedy Club. Go see Jackie the Joke Man performing.
Yeah, I always videotape them. They always sell out. That's the best show of the year. So come on out. It's great.
And follow you on Twitter, Jackie Martling, on Twitter.
It's Jackie Martling. Thank you, David.
It is just offensive and funny and hysterical and wrong and sweet and gentle and loving and sour.
It's
just
never offensive. When is it? Why do you put shit on the altar at an Italian wedding?
Why?
To keep the flies off the bride.
I know. Would love
what do you call one. A Puerto Rican with no arms?
What?
Trustworthy. Hey, hey, when does a Puerto Rican become a Spaniard?
When?
When he starts dating your sister.
Oh, my God. Where do you find these?
What would you call an Italian slum?
What?
A spaghetto.
Oh, Jesus.
Hey, did you hear there was a blackout in Connecticut yesterday?
No.
Yeah, they made him go back in. How do you make Polish sausage?
How?
With retarded pigs. Two guys are at work, and the first guy says, man, I am so horny. Jesus Christ, I am so horny. I got to get back just $200 I gave my wife last week. The other guy says, how do you know she'll still have the $200? He says, ah, she don't drink, she don't gamble, and she's got her own pussy. All right, so a guy brings a girl over to his house, and he's about to fool around with her, and the parrot goes, he's going to try to fuck you! The girl runs out. The guy's like, shut up, you jerk! Next night, he brings home a girl, and they start fooling around, and the parrot can't resist, and the parrot says, he's going to finger you and then try to fuck you! And the girl runs out. He says to the parrot, listen, you do that one more time, I'm going to slash your throat and flush you down the toilet. Ah! So the next night, he brings a girl over, and he's undressing her, and the parrot's not saying anything, and he's just about to get it on with her, and the parrot says, ah, you ready? Are you ready? Because he's going to fuck you. And the girl runs out. He says, all right. He takes the parrot, and he slashes the parrot's throat and flushes him down the toilet. And the girl comes back in. She says, I feel bad. I'm sorry I left. And the guy says, oh, this is great. And she says, well, I got to tell you, I have my period, so give me a second. I'll be right out.
Yeah.
So she goes in the bathroom and yanks out her tampon. She sits on the toilet, and all of a sudden she hears, I'm going to live! I'm going to live! She stands up, and there's the parrot in the toilet bowl with this big slice in his throat. And she says, what do you mean you're going to live? He says, if you can live with a gash like that, I can live with a gash like this.
Oh my God.
What's the worst thing about anal sex with a horse?
What?
When it's his turn.
When it's his turn.
What do you get when you cross Lassie with a pit bull?
What?
That's a dog that chews you to bits and then goes for help.
That's sweet. Oh, that's a sweet joke.
What do the gerbils say when the homos walk into the pet shop?
What?
Arf, arf, meow, meow. We never tell these horrible jokes. You know about the two pedophiles sitting on a park bench?
No.
Two pedophiles sitting on a park bench. And a 9-year-old girl walks by.
Yeah.
The first pedophile says, oh, man, look at that. And the other guy says, yeah, she must have been something in her day.
Oh,
so guy, as guy's at work and his boss says, listen, You want to marry my daughter? Will you please marry my daughter? She's very, very ugly, and she's very, very stupid. But she's wealthy because she's my daughter. And the guy says, let me see a picture. And he shows her a picture. Show him a picture. And he's like, oh, geez, oh, man, I'm sorry, boss. But yeah, geez, geez, no. And the boss says, come on, I'll buy you a mansion. I'll give you lots of money. And the guy thinks to himself, you know what? I can always put a bag over a head. What the hell? So he agrees.
Jesus.
So yeah. Him and this horrible beast of a woman get married.
Jesus, yeah.
And they move into a mansion in Port Washington on Long Island. Mm-hmm. And the place is spectacular, but she's just a, you know, just a pig, just a slob. So he's bored, so he goes out and buys an original Van Gogh. And he says to her, I gotta hang this picture. So he gets a ladder and takes the Van Gogh and goes up the ladder. He says, I need the hammer. She says, get the hammer. And she brings him the hammer. He says, you jerk, I need some nails too. She says, get the nails. She brings him nails, and he takes a nail and goes to knock it into the wall, and he accidentally hits his thumb with the hammer, and he goes, fuck. She goes, get the bag. You know about the little old lady who goes to the funeral parlor and her husband's laid out and she's there before the wake and she looks and she says, you know, Harold looks terrific. He really does. He does look pretty good there lying in this casket. But I will tell you that I always wished Harold would be buried in a blue suit, not a gray suit. And the funeral director says, no problem, lady. Hey, Annie, change heads on number three. So how did Helen Keller's parents punish her?
How?
They rearranged the furniture. I love
Helen Keller.
All right, I got it, you know.
Helen Keller jokes.
You know the worst day of Helen Keller's life?
Yeah.
That's the day she burned her mouth on a piece of pizza and couldn't taste anything either.
Wait a second. Oh, I see. Okay.
Oh, you're an idiot.
I'm trying to figure that.
You know about the two nuns walking along and this guy jumps out of an alley and fucks them both?
Jeez, yeah. Go ahead.
And then he runs away. And the one nun turns to the other nun. She's like, I can't believe that guy fucked us twice. Another girl, the other nun says, what do you mean twice? She says, well, we got to come back this way. All right. We're just about out. How's being a gynecologist like being a pizza delivery guy?
I don't know how.
They can smell it, but they can't eat it.
All right.
I got one more for you.
All right.
A guy meets a girl and they start dating and he likes her and he's fucking her and she's enjoying. She's sucking his cock. They're having fun. He's like, hey, this is a great relationship. She says, you know, but to tell you the truth, I have a fantasy that I like and I haven't told you about it yet. He says, what's that? She says, well, I'm a little weird. He says, that's all right. She says, well, I'd really appreciate it if you'd shit on me.
Okay.
And he's like, are you sure? She said, yeah, please. If you take a shit on me, it'd be great. So he pulls down his pants and they get undressed, you know, and he squats on top of her and takes a shit. She says, now fuck. He starts fucking her and the shit is squeezed between them. But she gets so hot, she gets crazy. So the next time he's with us, she's like, come on, do it. And he's like, what the hell? So he takes his clothes off and just takes a big shit on her chest. And she just goes nuts. She just can't believe it. And he starts to realize after a while that the more he shits, the more she loves it. So he eats and saves it up, and he gets to where he's dropping Carvels like a foot tall on. Jesus, there's a big chocolate Carvel, like a mound, like this huge pyramid, and then he squashes down on it and fucks her, and the shit is ever, and she goes nuts. So he saves up and saves up every time he does, you know, he eats it, saves up and goes and fucks her. He shits and fucks her.
Jesus.
So one time he eats so much and he's on his way and he just can't.
Jesus.
He can't wait. So he stops at a gas station and takes a massive shit. And then he goes to her house and they get undressed and he squats on top of her and he, and nothing's coming out. And all of a sudden he hears her. She's weeping. She's crying. And he says, "What the fuck is wrong with you?" She says, "You don't love me anymore."
Oh.
David, I love you. Let's do this again sometime if we can.
Yes, yes.
You know about the lawyer that smashed his Porsche into the tree? And the cops come and the lawyer's saying, they go, "My Porsche, fuck! My Porsche, fuck!" And the cop says, "You lawyers are amazing. You're such materialistic assholes. You're so concerned about your Porsche being smashed up, you don't even realize that your left arm's been ripped off." And the lawyer looks down and goes, "My Rolex, fuck!"
Make it a divorce attorney, please.
All right, that's good.
Yeah,
that's
just good. Just for personal reasons. Jackie the joke, wait, first
did
of
I
all,
ever tell you about the worst blowjob I ever had?
No.
It was so great. It was a snaggletooth the hiccups.
All right, all right. Yeah, no, you can't. I don't even. It was. Do it a cleaner version of it. It was a what?
It's a snaggletooth. Never mind.
A snaggletooth somebody.
It was a snaggletooth nun with the hiccups.
Okay.
Interesting. All right.
Oh my God. All right. Let me.
So I guess we still got some more jokes. That's
yeah.
Good.
Let me
That's
plug
good.
Some gigs here.
All right.
First of all, Twitter. What's your Twitter handle?
@ Jackie Martling, JACKIEMARTLING.
I laugh out loud every day at 420 marijuana time when I go to Twitter.
You know, people are retweeting and passing them around like crazy. It's so much fun.
Yeah, yeah. 7 p.m. Thursday, April 26th, Jackie will be signing his book, The Joke Man Battistern, at the Dolphin Bookshop and Cafe. That's at 299 Main Street, Port Washington, Long Island.
Yes.
Then 7 p.m. Saturday, June 9th, at the Brokerage Comedy Club in Belmore, Long Island, you can see Jackie the Joke Man perform at 7 p.m. Saturday, June 9th, at the Brokerage Comedy Club in Belmore, Long Island. The Joke Man, Battistern, is available in fine bookstores everywhere and on Amazon, or go to your website, which is JackieTheJokeMan.com. Thank you, sir.
It was a great time. Great time. And so guy's in a hospital bed and doctor says, "Well, I got some good news and some bad news." Guy says, "All right, what's the bad news first?" The doctor says, I had to amputate both your legs. The guy says, "Fuck, what's the good news?" He says, "The guy across the hall wants to buy your boots." I'm going away, David. I love you. I hope to see you very soon. Thank you.
I needed this. Thank you. Bye. If you're enjoying today's show, do me a favor and subscribe to it on iTunes, Stitcher. We have a YouTube channel. It's just audio, but some people like to listen to this show on YouTube, so subscribe to our YouTube channel and do me a favor and give us a good review on iTunes. You'd be amazed
how much that helps. Giving us a good review on iTunes moves us up. That's the way their algorithm works. So when you give us a good review on iTunes, you're really helping out.